Today I'm going to go hunting for hares with one of these. Now, a few weeks ago I went hunting for hares out in one of our paddocks just out here, and I used my old trusty hunting boomerang. Now I do hesitate to call it a boomerang now because I keep getting corrected all the time on my channel about the use of this thing, and in Australia it's quite accepted to call it a hunting boomerang, but obviously not internationally. It's called a kylie or a throw stick. Anyway, that's just some local slang or jargon or whatever from my area. That's what we call it. We call this a hunting boomerang. So just in case anyone wants to correct me any further, I'll just explain myself in advance. Of course I didn't hit any, but it was a lot drier and it wasn't lovely and green like it is now, so it was, the hunting conditions were a bit different, and it's worth a look because hares are a very different animal to hunt than rabbits. And I've recently had a video that's getting a bit more popular now where I've had quite a few shots thrown off at rabbits and had a few near misses, but hares are a lot more difficult to hunt because they're so much faster and more wary. So just sit back and relax, and I'll do the voiceover and talk you through the whole process of how I was sort of stalking and hunting a couple of hares, and yeah, enjoy the ride. There's a lot of grass. It's about a foot high, and I'm going to lose the boomerangs probably by the first throw. So I'm going to paint them with this pink spray paint. I know it takes a full day to go hard, but I'll just repaint it on after it comes off after a few throws today. So I'll just get into that now and make sure I don't lose these things that I've spent so much time making. There. And that'll be good enough to see in the grass. Right. So give that a go and see if we can get one. We'll just head over there, and where the wind's blowing, we need to keep out of their ears a bit and their nose, so we've got to go over to that corner of the paddock over there, work our way across. They come out of a saltbush paddock, which is on the south side of this grassy paddock, and they come out and they feed because there's lucerne underneath that dry grass. And we don't want them hearing them. We don't want them hearing us as we're going to go and try to pick them up that way. So we've got to go around the back of them as they're coming out of that paddock. Yeah.
Ah, listen to that sound.
Right. And there's one straight in front. He's in line of the fence post at the moment. He's just squatting down. This looks like a lump. I'll get behind this saltbush.
It's important when you're stalking any animal to use whatever cover you have available. In this case, I was creeping up behind an old man saltbush plant, which was 100 or so meters in front of me, but the hare was behind that. And also get down as low as possible, minimize the chance of the animal seeing you, and then also to reduce the noise that your feet are making.
Yes.
Don't step on any dry grass if you can help it, or leaves or twigs.
Can't get in.
And also step with your heel first, and you sort of roll your foot gently right through to the toe, and that reduces the shock and the vibration on the ground, so the animal is less likely to hear you there as well. In this case, it was pretty likely the hare saw us because we couldn't get quite enough cover. It either saw myself or the cameraman.
There's another one. We reckon we need to wait another 5 minutes.
It's getting a little bit darker.
And they'll come out in the grass. They're still coming out of the saltbush.
Sometimes you've just got to change a strategy, and that can mean all the difference between getting a successful hunt happening and for it to be a complete flop.
Yeah, if we stay in the shadows and just wait a couple more minutes. We'll be able to see them coming out then and staying in the grass more. But right now, they're just starting to come out of the bush paddock. So, our hares have very good hearing. It's probably better than rabbits. They can, their ears are longer and they can reach up higher. So they're about 2 to 2.5 times the size of a rabbit. They look very similar, but rabbits sort of hop, hares kind of run. Very different. They've got, their blood is really different too. They've got a really dark blood and they've got heaps of it. They're more of a long distance running type animal, whereas rabbits are explosive type animal. But they can only sprint about probably about 150 metres and they're puffed, whereas a hare will be able to go across the whole paddock and then just keep going.
It wasn't long before another hare came out of the saltbush paddock into the loosened paddock for a feed of fresh grass. Now, it was a long way off, it was probably 150 to 200 metres, so I had to get over another fence and do quite a bit of work to get towards it, to get it in range of throwing off boomerang at it. So it requires quite a bit of patience and concentration to get you to that spot, but that's what makes the whole thing fun anyway, isn't it? So here we go.
And that spells Kentucky, but it means paradise. You take a chicken and you kill it and you put it in a skillet and you fry it up a golden brown. That's southern cooking, and it's mighty nice. It don't cover a lot when you look on a map, but I wouldn't study no geography when it's sitting in my mammy's lap. You take a K and a E, N and a T, U and a CKY, that spells Kentucky, and it means paradise.
I can see the hair. They've gotten considerably closer. But he's aware that something's gone a bit wrong, so he's just sitting there with his ears perked up. Not too where he is. Got his head down, he's eating a bit of grass. So we can still sneak up on him. This grass is noisy. Shocking stuff, isn't it?
But I wouldn't study no geography when it's sitting in my mammy's lap. Take a K and a E, a N and a T and a U and a CKY, that spells Kentucky.
There's one here in the grass. It's bogged down. He smelt us. I said Kentucky. But, yeah, he might stay there long enough for me to get throw off.
This approach was very irritating to do because you can just hear the crunch, crunch, crunch of all that matter, vegetable, dry vegetable matter under my feet. And I knew the hare could hear every bit of it. So all I could do was to rely on the hope that he couldn't see me, which he probably could. So you just take it slowly and then hopefully they'll give you enough time to get close to them to be in a position where they're in range. But in this case, well and truly not. But it never stops you throwing off something, because you never know, they might stop for some stupid reason and they'll get bonked on the head. But he kept running like there was no tomorrow.
Well, I've decided to no longer walk through the saltbush paddock. It's too much dry grass. It hasn't rained a decent rain here for months. We haven't had our usual thunderstorm this summer to knock the dry grass down, so it's all very friable and loud. It's just like walking over bubble wrap. So we got out of there and I'm walking along this fence line and along the dirt, which makes almost no noise at all. So we'll be able to sneak up on the hares a bit more easily now. Just got to be patient, I'll come out again.
So I walked the full length of that fence, and just as the light was starting to fail and I was walking my way back, is when the hares started to come out.
One right in front of us. About 100 metres down, there's a hare. Yep, he's on the other side. If we stay still, he might come out.
By the time the hares had settled into their grazing spot, they were well over 100 metres in front of me, so I had a lot of stalking work to do, but I was quite hopeful because they hadn't smelt or seen or heard me at all, and they were very relaxed, and they were also facing away from me, so I knew I was in for a good chance of getting close enough and to get them into range. Now, I thought I started off pretty well. The hares couldn't see me, but then I think they did see me, one of them did. And you can tell by how their ears go as to how well they can see the things around them. So they'll put their ears flat on the back of their head from a very vertical position. So watch the hare on the left. I think that is probably the female. The ears go up and then straight back down. That means she's seen or smelt or heard something. And she's wary, but because she doesn't know where or what's going on, she's just decided to run away and get a little bit more distance from whatever else she could sense. So that just makes it a little bit harder again for me. I have to catch up to them, and halfway through this walk towards them, my legs are really starting to burn, and I had to ignore that and just keep as low as I could and keep as quiet as I could, and at the same time as fast as I could, because the hares were getting further and further out into the paddock, but I couldn't go out there and go after them because that's where the grass was and was going to be too noisy for me to go that way, so I had to stick to the fence. So it was a bit of a paradox at that point, so I had to kind of go as quick as I could and then at the last second run after them. Now you'll see what I've done. Every time the hares move, that's when I can move, but when one of them has stopped, I have to stop as well, because that's when they're more wary and I'm likely to be spotted if I'm still moving along with them. Now I've just sped this up to double time because it's dragging on a fair bit. While this was happening, I'm chasing these two hares. More hares started coming out of the saltbush paddock. So there was one further up on the left there starting to come out. And also, you'll see very shortly, there's also one on the left, but it stays inside the fence. And because I'm concentrating so much on the other two hares out in the paddock, that I didn't see this hare, which was probably within my range to... I didn't see it, it was just right there, and I could have thrown a shot off at it, but that's the hunting game for you. In fact, I can see that hare there now. It's just on the left of the fence, but I was concentrating so much on these other two hares that I knew I was getting close and I was about to pounce. So here we go. On my first shot, it was pretty wild, because when you're running and throwing a boomerang at the same time, it's almost impossible, So I settled into the shot after this terrible throw and nearly picked it up. On the second, it just flew a bit short. And the hare actually nearly injured itself on the fence, so I could have been lucky and just caught it by default. But anyway, it wasn't a bad try, I thought, considering I've never actually hit a hare before in my life.
Well, a hard luck Paul can't stand his ground. Well, he was a good Paul, but he done gone down.
Lord, Lord, he got them browns very blue.
Well, a hard luck of Papa standing in the rain. If the world was corn, well, they couldn't buy grain.
Lord, Lord, he got them browns very blue.
Well, that's how it's almost done, folks. Don't forget to like and subscribe if you haven't already, and turn on your notifications while you're at it, and I'll catch you on the next episode.
Just get me outside with my boomerang. Get me outside with my